Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Musical Innertube. I'm Don Rooney.
And I'm John Timpane. You know, Don's had quite a career in radio and television, where he's been an air personality, a news anchor, even a TV weatherman.
And John has been a college professor. He's written several books, and he's been an editor and features writer at the Philadelphia Inquirer newspaper.
We first teamed up for a radio show in college. On one show, we introduced a soothing musical interlude.
But we stumbled, and it came out Musical Innertube.
And that became the name for this podcast, where we talk with interesting people about their interesting lives, difference makers who really make a difference. And we're very happy on the Musical Innertube today to introduce to you David Loud, who has led a life of music, especially on Broadway. He's been a conductor, a music director, a vocal arranger for many musicals, and a pianist and an actor. And I guess he's best known for collaborations with Candor and Ebb and Stephen Sondheim. We'll talk about that a little bit, but he's currently on the faculty of the Manhattan School of Music, and his new autobiography, Facing the Music, is published by Regan Arts, and I can heartily recommend it. It is beautifully written with real feeling for people and music and life. So thank you for that book, David, and welcome to the Musical Innertube.
Well, thank you for that beautiful introduction. That was extraordinary.
You know, you take us through so many parts of your life, from shoveling horse manure to the life of the conductor. And I thought I would start by just a delicious, you know, four paragraph description right at the beginning of the book of what it's like to be a conductor. You say that on my podium, I'm at the focal point of three distinct worlds. The first one is the world on stage. You're looking up at the actors. They perform over your head, but occasionally glance down at me to ensure that we are synchronized. And you say, I see their shoes mostly. Mm-hmm. And below you is the orchestra, and you have that relationship with them. I love the way that you describe how part of your job as the conductor is to encourage them to get inside the music and to inhabit the sort of imaginative world of that music by embodying the music on the podium. And then behind you, unseen but always felt, is the audience, you write. I feel them on the back of my neck. I sense their attention and their boredom. I hear their laughs and their coughs. I try to watch the show through their new eyes and listen through their fresh ears. Is that still your experience after all these years? Do you still have that? You know,
it's a thrill to be on the podium conducting a Broadway musical or any musical anywhere. It's an extraordinary place to be. You're connected in so many levels and so many ways with so many people, and you are literally the beating heart of this organism that exists to tell a story.
I don't think I've ever read such a good description of what a conductor does. I'm a musician myself, and I'm used to hearing from people that the best musician on the stage is the conductor. And I know what they mean by that. One of them is
pray for that to be true,
right? But you are actually three people in one. You are conducting a musical ensemble. You're there for the actors. And you're also sort of an audience sensor. You know, if you think they're falling asleep, you might be able to do something for the musicians. If the actors are out of sync, you might be able to do something about that. I mean, you're right. You really have a lot of responsibility. But I get the sense from your book that you enjoyed that it wasn't a burden.
It's a place of privilege to be. It was always such a... It was such a high and such a honor to be in that spot for a Broadway show. When a Broadway show is clicking along and everything's working, there is nothing better. There's no better feeling that I've ever experienced. They're not always like that, of course. I mean, I've had perfectly horrible nights on the podium. Mostly it's a place of great joy.
I'm interested in finding out, David, what that synchronization is exactly. You talk about having those three levels, but the first two are the levels that you're immediately in touch with from the beginning of the production on, and that is the musicians and the actors. And you talk in the book about actors looking at each other during a musical number to sort of stay in sync. And of course, you're trying to stay in sync with the music as well. How does that all, when it comes together, how does that all come together? Is it mostly feel, or is it just that old Carnegie Hall line, practice, practice, practice? Yeah.
Well, there is that. And there's also just, there's the energy of everybody doing their job at the same time in a way that allows you to, you're always walking a fine line in a Broadway show, trying to make it fresh and trying to make it exactly the way it was last night. And those two contradictory things happen sort of in the air around you. You discover something new, and then maybe there's a little leeway to take a little, time going through this phrase or press through this one to catch up with the singer. You're always negotiating the difference between keeping it in the moment and making sure that you're doing exactly what you're supposed to do to make the show work. There's just a sort of a concentration of energy that you have to just trust and go with, I think, from everybody in a show. It's always about taking responsibility for your actions while being constantly aware of the effects that they have and other people's needs. That was a very heady explanation, but.
Well, I totally get it. It's hard when people have asked me to explain what it's like being a musician, being up on stage and playing, like say in a small quartet or something and taking a solo. On the one hand, it is extremely, extraordinarily concentrating, right? You have to concentrate. On the other hand, it's almost as though you're disembodied. There's this other sense that's really hard to explain where you're sort of going along both on practice and I don't know even what to call it, really. It's very difficult to bring across to people who don't do it every night.
It's one of the things I was trying to really capture in the book, though, because I don't think that a lot of people have written from that perspective. And conducting is a mystery to most people.
Yeah.
They look at the man making those movements, and they don't always see the connection between the movements and the music that they hear. And there is something mysterious about conducting. Everybody does it differently. And the way they connect to the musicians and respond to the music is mysterious, I think.
And I'm glad to hear you say that, because that was, because that explains why it's so hard to talk about. I mean, there's part of music that everybody knows,
the way it affects them.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. We listen to it. We go to the things that move us. But then there's the other part, which we don't have language for, but we know is there. I mean, you know it. You've just said
how the sausage is actually made.
Yeah, exactly.
As a person who conducts music and also does accompaniment in Broadway shows, you're more often called upon to be an interpreter of music as opposed to an originator of music. And how does that differ when you're given someone else's music and told to make it work?
Well, that's one of my favorite things to do, to realize a composer's vision, to create a vocal arrangement so that what, was just a melody is now a four-part arrangement for a choir or backup singers or whatever the music, demands. I love doing that. I love working with the tunes I'm given with and seeing what we can, how to arrange them, how to routine the songs. That's a big responsibility of the music director occasionally in Broadway shows. It varies completely depending on the composer you're working with. Stephen Sondheim writes out all of his accompaniments exactly the way he wants to hear them, and you do them exactly the way he wrote them, and they're perfect. John Kander writes a melody and hands it over to you, and, with him and in consultation with him, you work out how it's going to modulate, what the exact accompaniment will be, how the vamp he writes will develop. There's lots more freedom and invention required working in that situation. And that's that always brings me great joy. And there are people on the spectrum all around, all in both directions on that particular issue.
Somebody once asked me, actually quite recently, on the passing of Sondheim, they said that they felt that he was the American Shakespeare in some ways. And
I agree. Or Mozart or yes. Michelangelo or, you know, there are very few people in that list, but he is definitely one of them.
I went to see the recent Broadway production of Company.
Oh, yes, with all the different genders.
Yes, where it was all gender. It was all gender reversed. I'd seen it. I'd seen the original, and both were spectacular, and both made me feel absolutely different.
I'm sure. Really, I haven't seen the revival yet, but the original production of Company and that album was, it was such a powerful force in my life. The songs are so fresh, and no song in Company sounds like any song you've ever heard before.
You had the privilege of working with Stephen Sondheim, and
right.
And I have heard that he gives you everything all done. You know, he's done the arrangements. He's done everything but picking the popcorn that's sold in the lobby. and I'm just wondering, from your perspective as an artist, what is it about him? What was it about him for you?
For me, it was. Well, I feel like in addition to being the extraordinary craftsman he is, in terms of the way his lyrics are always perfect and always surprising and take you in places you never expect. And the music, I think, is the same. It's very fresh. It's always telling the story that needs to be told. What I think he doesn't always get credit for is what a great playwright he also is. How his songs can delineate an entire character in just a few words sometimes. How some characters in his musicals, you learn about their entire backstory from a song he writes. You know, I think of a song like Leave You from Follies, mm-hmm. where by the end of it, you know everything about this marriage that seems to be about to fall apart that you... And the playwright hasn't given you any of that information. It's all from the lyricist, all from Stephen Sondheim. I feel like I learned about adult relationships from,
from you could.
And from all of his work. It was so specific, and the details that he reveals about his characters taught me that you can have two emotions in your heart at one time that contradict each other, that you can... you know, the way secrets are revealed in lyrics is always so interesting, where the characters don't quite know that they are revealing about themselves what they're not intending to reveal. And that's a great Sondheimian trick.
Oh my goodness. Yes. Yeah.
Now you started your career with an unusual Sondheim bomb, and that was Merrily We Roll Along in 1981. I had watched the documentary movie that was put together.
Alani's that wonderful movie, yeah.
Oh yeah, the worst thing that ever happened, I think is the title of it. I went to watch it again over the weekend, and all of the streaming services seem to have pulled it, which is just stupid. But let's talk about specifically what went wrong, because you had Sondheim, you had Hal Prince, you had some real heavy hitters in the cast. Jason Alexander, George Firth did the book. What went wrong?
Well, it was a very ambitious project, and they were, Sondheim and Prince were coming off a decade of writing and producing and directing the five of the greatest musicals ever presented. I mean, Company, Follies, A Little Night Music, Pacific Overtures, and Sweeney Todd. And the expectations for Merrily sort of were colossally high after Sweeney Todd, which is really sort of his mid-career masterpiece. Mm. Merrily was based on a play by Kaufman and Hart that goes backwards in time. And that is a very hard thing to pull off in the theater. when a scene ends, you generally want to know what happens next. And Merrily keeps not giving you that. It tells you what happened before. And I mean, none of us were around going to the theater in the 30s. I don't know if the original worked or not. It was a play, not a musical. And maybe it was a little easier to do that with a play. I don't know. But the going backwards is so hard and took most of the work, I think. Hal's concept of casting young people in the show so that by the end of the play, when we were playing people our age, it was very truthful. And the last 45 minutes of Merrily were fantastic, but we had lost the audience by then. Physically lost them. They were walking out, muttering angrily, not enjoying it.
I remember
very difficult.
A phrase in your book where you said you couldn't, when you were in the middle of the play from the stage, you couldn't understand why the exit sign kept blinking.
I did. Wild to realize that it was the audience's heads going by the lit sign. They were walking out. It was so sad.
And as I understand it, somebody is going to try to redo it as a movie and take the full 20 years to do the movie.
That is so unbelievably audacious and brilliant. I hope it works. I'm kind of nervous that it won't because everybody tries to keep fixing Merrily, and I haven't really seen it ever work the way I always hoped it would. But the score is a masterpiece, and no matter what, there's always interesting things in Merrily. It may be just one of those pieces that people are going to tinker with for the rest of time.
Well, there are things like, this reminds me of you mentioned Candor and Ebb. And I think about Chicago, which had two lives, really.
Absolutely.
You know,
the world wasn't ready for it the first time.
Right. I mean, it did okay the first time, but it wasn't what it became, which was this, which is this world beating, amazing musical. They tweaked it. They worked on it. People always do through time. But I'm wondering if you could talk about Candor and Ebb, who are so different in their ways of working from Stephen Sondheim, and what drew you to their work and their music.
Well, I was so lucky. Early in my career, I met the director Scott Ellis, and he and Susan Stroman and Tommy Thompson and I put together this little off-Broadway review of Candor and Ebb's songs. And they didn't need to pay attention to that. They had lots of things going, but they came and worked with us and fell in love with the show and with the performers that we had chosen, and very much became a part of the creation of that little off-Broadway piece, which was quite successful. And John just hooked on to me as a music director, and I music directed four more of his Broadway shows, and it was just such a privilege to keep working with a composer of that stature. Fred died before we got a couple of those up. Mm. He didn't make it for Curtains or The Visit, but he was there for Steel Pier, and they're very different from Sondheim. Sondheim labors over his magnificent creations, and Candor and Ebb write very quickly and very intuitively. They sometimes would hide how quickly they wrote from their collaborators if they were out of town with a show and had to, you know, and were tasked with writing a new song or something. They would go into the music room and write it in 45 minutes. Then they'd go away for a few days and come back looking all tired and, you know, as if they'd spent every little piece of energy writing it. It's because they didn't want to think that people to think how, you know, to see how easy it was for them. I'm exaggerating a little bit.
Sure. Even at the easy level, I think we can agree that writing a Broadway show is not an easy thing to do, even, right. You know, comparatively.
And when they talk about some of the songs that they wrote in 45 minutes, New York, New York being one of them.
Which is their single most famous song.
And actually, an extraordinarily complexly constructed lyric that rhymes in places that lyrics don't necessarily rhyme. And there, from what I understand, never having actually been in the private room when the two of them write, but hearing John talk about the way they wrote, they're both fantastic improvisers. John improvises at the piano instinctively. He sometimes just puts his hands on the keys and watches as things tumble out. And Fred, John describes as being able to improvise verbally in the same way that a musician improvises at the piano, which is such an interesting, I'd never thought about a lyricist working like that, but that was the nature of their collaboration. They could just improvise together and come up with things. And he says that Fred could improvise in that way where, start spreading the news, I'm leaving today, rhymes with, these vagabond shoes are longing to stray, much later in the lyric, which rhymes with, oh God, I'm not going to be able to think of the third one.
Something's melting away.
These little town blues.
Little town blues. Melting away.
Yes.
And your ear doesn't really hear those as rhymes because they're far apart, but your ear does notice somehow on some gut level that these lines have been constructed so artfully. Much more complex than it seems.
Yes. Did they always work in the same room together? Is that how they tended to work?
Only. Okay. Always and only. Yeah, which is not the current style, you know.
Right.
Everybody collaborates over the internet and, you know, you send off a lyric or, you know, well, there are 100 different ways to collaborate. But John and Fred always wrote in the same room and always took great joy in the writing. It was their favorite thing to do.
Let's talk about your collaboration with Scott Ellis. When you met him, you started working on some very big projects, and he was a mover and shaker, pretty much, that took you along for a pretty nice ride.
Well, you know, the people you cut your teeth with in the theater are often the ones who you float up with.
Yes.
And you never know. It could be the person that you meet in summer stock, you know, at some terrible rundown summer theater who turns into the director that hires you for the job that makes your career. People want to work with people they know. And when you bond with someone in a production anywhere and they want to work with somebody that they are comfortable with, you know, I think you're much more likely to get the job. And that's how it worked with Scott and I. We did this crazy production of a two-person musical called Billy Bishop Goes to War together in Portland, Maine. We ended up doing it all over the country. And then when Scott's directing career took off, he just sort of instinctively reached to me to be his music director. And so he gave me my Broadway debut and She Loves Me. And we worked on four other musicals together. And it was just, it always felt like family working with that particular group of artists that Scott always wanted to work with.
Susan Stroman was in that, right?
Absolutely. That group. Yes, she choreographed And the World Goes Round and Steel Pier with us, and is now a brilliant director and choreographer herself.
Her big thing was that I remember the thing that brought her to prominence was directing The Producers for Mel Brooks.
The Producers, yeah. Well, her first big Broadway smash was Crazy for You.
Okay.
The choreography for that, which was just so creative and spectacular.
We'll return to our show in just a moment, but first, this pleasing musical innertube.
David Loud has worked as a music supervisor, music director, conductor, vocal and dance arranger, pianist, and actor. His new autobiography, Facing the Music, is published by Rig and Arts, an imprint of Simon & Schuster.
David Loud is now on the faculty of the Manhattan School of Music. To learn more, get Facing the Music or check out his webpage at msmnyc.edu/faculty/David-Loud.
And now, back to the musical innertube.
you know, I want to give you a chance to talk about Parkinson's, which is part of your life. I know that one thing about the way that you speak about Parkinson's is that it's almost a conversation between Parkinson's and music. Parkinson's, they're both going to be in your life.
That's right.
And one is helping you through the other. And I'd love you to talk more about what it's like today for you and how you work now.
Well, it's every day is a journey on this particular subject. Parkinson's is a progressive disease. It has new things in store for you as it goes along over time. And it's been the great challenge of my existence to somehow come to terms with the fact that I have this, figure out how to function despite it, and try to not let it ruin my life. And that it has been a long grappling with those problems. My first instinct when I was diagnosed was to keep it secret and to hide it as much as I could, which was ridiculous because you actually can't eventually. And I didn't discuss it with my collaborators, and I pretended that things were fine when they weren't. And it became a very false place to live. And it was very difficult for me to trust that if I did reveal my status as a person with Parkinson's, that people would continue to hire me and would want to work with me, and I would be perceived as damaged and incapable of doing my job. Mm. I always did my job very, very well. I showed up on time. I never missed performances. I was the strong one. But when I couldn't hide it anymore, I sort of started telling people, who mostly said, "I know, and thank you for finally telling us, allowing us to ask you about it and to help you and to encourage you." And people were so kind, and there was no diminution in my job offers, that people found different ways for me to work. I became a musical supervisor instead of the actual conductor in places. I focused more on arranging, and the physical toll of doing 8 shows a week on Broadway is extreme. That's a big workout, especially on a show like Ragtime or Sweeney Todd, where you've got, you know, big acts of music. But I found many different ways to continue to collaborate with the people I knew and loved and trusted, and it became not as much a problem as I had ever dreamed that it was. And in fact, the fear of the exposure was worse than the actual disease at times. And it was such a relief to come out as a person with Parkinson's. Coming out as a gay man in the business was easy.
Yes.
As a person with Parkinson's was much harder for me.
I was just thinking about that, that it was a second coming out. It was, it's
absolutely
sort of like,
yeah.
And people seemed to surprise you with their kindness.
Oh my, it was overwhelming. The amount of love and support, and we're so lucky in the theater because we exist in a family, and you collect the people along the way who you want to bring along with you. You know, when you go and do some horrible production of Lil Abner in some wretched little theater in Des Moines, if somebody, you know, strikes you in the chorus, says, "Well, she'd be great in anything, and she sure hits a high C," well, you know, you might bring her along and she becomes part of your life, and you do your next 10 shows together. That's the way my career has been anyway. I see the gems and try to continue to work with them.
I like the way also that you deal with the revelation of Parkinson's in your book. It's not all at once. It's given in chapter by chapter, spread throughout the book. you eventually, I want to say, came around to it after denying it yourself for quite a while and going through a couple of different neurologists.
I was diagnosed by the strangest man. He was accurate in his diagnosis, but I literally walked into his office and he said, "How long have you had Parkinson's?" And I didn't know what Parkinson's was.
Yeah,
I can't believe that he did that to me. It was awful and funny and weird and.
Jesus.
And then according to the book, he tried to get you to hire his grandniece?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Actually, I did audition her. She turned out to have a very nice voice. That wasn't really what I had gone to him to.
Yeah, that's like every writer talks about running into somebody who's got a screenplay.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
He also was in the habit of mentioning other patients of his to me who were in show business or in the arts. And since my focus was on keeping it a secret and trying to cover up my symptoms, it just got to be too much. And I found another very capable, lovely doctor who has no relatives in show business.
But again, the slow reveal in the book is kind of does take the reader through your own grappling with coming to terms with having the disease.
It's the lens ultimately through which I think the book has to look. It changed everything about my life, and everything in my life had to be renegotiated. You know, my relationship with my husband has changed in every way. And in a way it's healthier now because of the Parkinson's. I mean, that's one of the sort of miracles that can happen in your life when terrible things happen. By dealing with them, by confronting them, by wrestling them into place, sometimes other things get better. Very moving for me to discover.
I mean, I'm struck by the same truth that you've just said, very movingly, with the way that you dealt with your sexual abuse at Phillips Exeter, that you leaned into the music. You found a way through.
Oh, that's always been my touchstone. And I don't know whether sexual abuse is the right term for what happened to me in Exeter. He was a flirty teacher who put me in a bad couple of situations. It never got as bad as it might have been. It could have been much worse than it was. Mm-hmm. And that teacher, the teacher was eventually let go from Exeter, but given letters of recommendation that didn't mention any of the problems that he had created at Exeter. And I wanted to write and make sure that his story with me was part of the public record.
Music seems to have pulled you out of a lot of tailspins. You've had that. You've had the Parkinson's. You talk about your family falling apart, the divorce of your parents. So music seems to be the healing force that kind of runs through the book.
I think you're so right. And it's always been central in my life. It's just, I knew what I wanted to do when I was 6 years old. I've never changed my mind. I've never, I've found different places to be within the musical theater, as an actor, as a pianist, as a conductor, as a, and as an arranger, and now as a teacher. But I always had music, and that has been the constant. There were 15 minutes when I was in high school when I wanted to be a Supreme Court justice. But other than that, it's been completely music.
Well, that's good, because you don't want to sit in front of those senators for any length of time. We're seeing that now. Yes.
Yeah, we're seeing that now with Ketanji. I wanted to say one last thing, and this is on the very, very bright side of things. And this is one of the best evocations of how reading figures in a person's life. I mean, you read Act One by Moss Hart.
Right.
Which was such a big moment for you. And then you did a very interesting thing. You realized when you found out that a lot of musicals had novels or books as the basis, you went back and you read many of those. So this was everything from Edna Ferber to The Once and Future King. I mean, you became a literate person, and it was the reading. And also you were thrilled by the lyrics of Gilbert and Sullivan. It's right. Just a really great there's a mini autobiography of a reader inside this book, which is very precious, I think.
Fascinating. That's so interesting to hear you respond to it that way. I have this great collection just from going to used bookstores my entire life of novels that the musicals are based on, plays that musicals are based on. It's my favorite thing, watching that process of adaptation, you know, and trying to follow along with the writers as they chose the moments to musicalize and how they translated material from the original into the musical. Musicals are mysterious. They work for reasons that we don't understand. They don't work for reasons that we don't understand. There is no formula for writing a musical. If there were, everybody would be able to write a musical, and very few people can.
No, it's very hard.
And you never know whether they're going to fly until you're there starting the overture and feeling the audience on the back of your neck. And, you know, in 2.5 hours, you're going to know.
Yeah, or whether or not that exit sign starts blinking.
Yeah, that's a good way to tell as well.
Let's quickly go through some of the people that you have worked with. If we throw out some names, if you could give us some impressions. One of the first names that comes to mind is Chita Rivera. You worked with her. What was that like?
We developed The Visit over a period of 14 years of readings and workshops and out-of-town engagements. And Chita Rivera was in my soul because we had the West Side Story album when I was growing up and the Bye Birdie album when I was growing up. So her voice was very familiar to me. And to conduct Chita, when Chita's doing a show, she is in charge of everything. She worries about every chorus girl to, you know, every character man. She's the boss. She's the grand poobah of everything. You know, in the most wonderful way. She just is this loving entity who takes care of the company. And to conduct her is to sort of enter into Chita's world. And it was just divine spending that time with her. She is the heart and soul of Broadway.
And another very strong woman that you worked with was Barbara Cook. You caught her toward the end of her career.
Yes, making her return to Broadway after 50 years away.
Wow.
Barbara surprised me with her foul mouth. I love to swear. What the fuck are we doing? Jesus Christ, she would say. How could he ask me to do that? And she was quite nervous about coming back to the Broadway theater. And she was difficult at the beginning, a little hostile, very, very critical of the other people on stage with her. And as we rehearsed Sondheim on Sondheim, all of that melted away, and she sort of rediscovered the joy of a company. Mm. She'd been spending all of her time doing solo work, and that, I guess, requires a certain, you know, a different kind of collaborative process. But by the time we were performing, she thought she was in the finest company ever assembled. took such joy in the work that it was a real complete transformation from the suspicion with which he started.
Interesting.
You had some very nice things to say in the book about David Hyde Pierce when you worked with him on Curtains.
Yes, you did.
He David Hyde Pierce is an extraordinary human being. He is so generous and so giving of his time and his energy. When he was starring in Curtains, he knew the names of every usher and their children, parties that always included the orchestra and the box office staff and the, you know, the people who delivered the rat poison. I don't know. You know, just everybody involved in making a Broadway show work. And also set such a beautiful example for the younger people in the company. I mean, the kids who were making their Broadway debuts in Curtains were modeled by David Hyde Pierce and Deborah Monk and Karen Ziemba and Michael McCormick and just great veterans of the theater who wouldn't dream of missing a performance ever. You know, as long as they had both legs, that show was going to go on with them. And as a result, our ensemble never missed performances because they were being modeled by, you know, the troopers of all time. David created a theater filled with joy that we all wanted to come to each night to work it. It was a beautiful thing. And a show needs a leader. A show needs a leader like that. Someone to set the tone, someone to exhibit by how hard they're working, how seriously they're taking the job, what your behavior is going to be like. I had that with David Hyde Pierce, also Boyd Gaines, and She Loves Me, provided yes. that kind of leadership that just, it transforms the experience from, you know, the drudgery of repeating the same show 8 times a week to the joy of discovering what you can do 8 times a week.
This has been a wonderful talk. I want everybody to go out and get your book, Facing the Music, which really does in more ways than one, and is beautifully written. That's the other thing. It's an experience. It's a wonderful experience just to read a book like this, but also to experience life like this. And if anybody has ever wondered what it's like to work on Broadway, they will have many of their questions answered, because it's, as you say, it's a world that is not a lot of people know about who are not in it. So thank you so much for being on the Musical Innertube.
Well, what an interesting conversation. I can't thank you enough for including me.
Thank you for listening to the Musical Innertube.
You can get in touch with us by email. We're at musicalinnertube, that's all one word, @gmail.com.
You can follow us on Twitter @MInnertube, capitalize the M and I.
Our webpage is Musical Innertube, musical spelled with 2 A's, .libsyn, spelled L-I-B-S-Y-N, .com.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. These little town blues are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York, New York. Never sleeps and find I'm A number one, top of gonna make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York.